Adaptation is one of the basic phenomena of biology, but what does evolutionism have to do with adaptation? Well, not much. Evolutionism is really just an idea that somehow random genetic mutations cause changes in populations over time. It is not a scientific idea, because scientific ideas, such as theories, allow us to predict future events with some degree of certainty. But honest evolutionists tell us that evolutionism cannot predict how things will change, only that they will change. This is like a weather forecaster telling us, "I don't know how the weather is going to change this week. All I can tell you is that it will change." In other words, evolution has zero predictive powers about future events, and that makes it about the most unscientific idea in the history of ideas that have been labeled scientific. Evolutionists also tell us that genetic mutations are the engines that drive evolution. Genes are made of DNA, and DNA is shaped like a spiral staircase. Your DNA is a vast storehouse of information, and every three steps on a DNA staircase contains information called a codon. Think of codons as three-letter words, and genes as strands of DNA containing thousands of these words in specific patterns. In fact, if you added up all the individual stair steps in just one of your cells, it would equal about 3 billion steps, or 1 billion codons. And every time one of your cells divides, all of the DNA is duplicated. Occasionally, copying errors are made. Scientists call these mistakes mutations. Evolutionists believe these mistakes drive the creation of new and different species, and these mistakes are how, over millions of years, bacteria turned into people. But is this what 21st century scientific research tells us? No. 21st century science tells us that genetic mutations are neutral, neither benefiting or harming the organism, or they are harmful, and often kill the organism. Some evolutionists say that evolution is a progressive ladder, moving from less complex bacteria to more complex people. But other evolutionists say evolution is not a progressive ladder, that it is not a drive towards complexity, as Richard Dawkins believes, but diversification, as Stephen Jay Gould believed. So which one is it? Or is it neither? Well, I think it's neither. What men like Dawkins and Gould try to do is help us understand the origins of life and explain the unity and diversity we see around us. But it is important to understand that everyone, myself included, begins with some assumptions that have yet to be proven, or in the case of origins, are unprovable. I believe in 6 days and a rest. God is good, I do confess. I believe in Adam and Eve, in a tree and a garden, in a snake and a thief. You see, science has limits, and one of its limits is that science alone cannot explain past events. And ultimately, whether they admit it or not, everyone has some faith-based ideas about how life got started, and their faith is based on either man's ideas about the past or providence and revelation. I think it is amazing that God reveals to us in Holy Scripture that He created different kinds of living things. And what do we see around us? We see evidence that God had a plan. And with that plan, He created a variety of things. We see unity and diversity. I think it is also interesting that Charles Darwin thought God was lying about this, which is why he wrote Origin of Species. And I think acceptance of Darwin's ideas has hindered the progress of science for far too long. If you get out in nature and take an honest look at it, you do see diversity. Different kinds of bears, different kinds of sea turtles, different kinds of damselfishes. But you also see limits. no 8-million-pound damselfishes, and no 1/4-inch-long adult grizzly bears. This is consistent with 21st-century genetics research. We have a name for unlimited genetic change in an organism. It is called cancer. What we also don't see in nature is the evolutionary idea of genetic mutations benefiting organisms and creating new species. But what we do see is some diversity within kinds, along with what 21st century scientists are revealing to us regarding epigenetics. Epigenetics is about gene expression. For example, in each of our cells we have 46 chromosomes, 23 from our mothers and 23 from our fathers. We started life as a fusion of an egg and sperm cell, which divided into 2 cells and then 4 cells, and so on and so on. But how did some of those cells know to turn into eye cells, and others into skin cells, and others into stomach cells, and so on? Inside our bodies exist a huge diversity of cell types, each with the same set of information, but as we developed, no evolution was occurring to create this cellular diversity, just the turning on and off of certain genes at certain times and locations. The same thing happens to all plants and animals, not only as they develop inside the egg, seed, or womb, but afterwards as well. And certain environmental factors can alter which genes are turned on and off. If the environment does change, causing certain genes to be turned on and off, this pattern can be passed down to the offspring, which also allows them to be more adapted to the new environment. It is important to understand that epigenetics is not evolutionism, because remember, evolutionism requires a genetic mutation. A mutation is simply a copying mistake when DNA duplicates during cell division. If evolutionism were true, then mutations would be the engines that drive evolutionism, but as scientists are finding out more often than not, the engines seem to be off. So did life evolve through one genetic mistake after another? Or was life created with the ability to alter gene expression during its life cycle? And what about humans? Were we created separately from other organisms and given the role of managing creation as God reveals in Genesis 1? Well, I hope you believe God's word, which says that man is supposed to take care of God's creation. If you don't believe his word, I hope it is obvious to you that humans are part of nature and are in charge, and we need to manage it wisely. And as you have watched this video, I hope it is very obvious to you how animals were designed to adapt to humans and our activities, whether it be the construction of an offshore oil and gas platform, fishing in an Alaskan stream, or swimming along a Hawaiian reef. So why is there so much diversity? Well, I think the best answer is not slow and gradual evolutionism by time and chance over millions of years, but instead creation by God as described in Genesis. And not only did the God of Scripture create each organism with unique sets of information stored in their DNA, he gave life the ability to adapt to environmental changes by expressing certain genes at certain times. This is what 21st century science is revealing to us, and this is what nature and nature's God has always revealed, if we simply look